Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back. I hope you guys had a chance to stretch your legs and are ready for the next stretch, because we have a powerful, and I mean powerful, group of women that are here to share. We have our very own Jennifer Sanders from KXAN, who's going to moderate the next segment that will cover women in power and women in finance. The one thing I want to say about that is representation matters. And these ladies are here to represent and bring a little estrogen into the room. So ladies, come on up.
Well, good afternoon. Thank y'all for hanging with us. Oh my goodness. And if you could see the view that I see right now, it is beautiful. All of this melanin. I know that Dwayne mentioned that earlier. This feels good. Just the black excellence in the house. So give yourselves a round of applause right now. So I'm so incredibly excited about this. Anyone who knows me knows I love good times with good girlfriends, girlfriends who are empowering, girlfriends who will help you rise to the next level. And I don't know these ladies personally, but I've read their bios and I know that they are powerhouses. So take out your notebooks, because you're gonna take a lot of notes tonight. And we have a limited time. So I wanna start with each of you just to give everyone context about why you're on the stage, who you are. Talk to us about who you are and what you do and what you hope to give the people here today.
Awesome. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Toni Sanders. I'm your certified financial education instructor, your licensed financial professional. I simply want to come to you to educate you and empower you and equip you to make better financial decisions. I believe that we're highly educated, we're professionally successful, but we're financially illiterate. So I'm going to change the narrative by giving you the tools that you need to make better decisions.
She came in hot. All right, y'all. My name is Yasmin Smith. Everybody calls me Yaz. I'm a born and raised Austinite. And I happen to be, come on now, because there ain't much of us now. But love my new neighbors too now. Don't get it twisted. But I am a first generation graduate and the managing and founding partner of Abundance Law PLLC, where we help you welcome abundance into your life. As a young child from a young mother, I learned very quickly that the rules to the game are not fair. And so I dedicated my life to learning those rules, understanding those rules, constructing, creating those rules at a local level to ensure that my people and the people that came from my people had the same access to wealth and financial freedom.
Hi, I'm Beanie Coleman. So I'm gonna kind of probably come in from the social impact side of this today. I'm gonna stay focused there just to kind of balance everything out. I have a consultancy that I'm the founder and CEO of called 212 Catalyst. It's nonprofit. We help people to help people. So we work with organizations that are out in the community doing great work, and we support them in any aspect of the business model. So that could be strategic planning, development, data, finance, all those pieces, board engagement, stewardship, even all the ugly stuff that people don't like, but are great at the mission. We help balance that out. And we have put, I have to say, $23 million in the accounts of BIPOC-led organizations over the last 4 years.
And I am Tammy Denmark. I know y'all met me just a minute ago. I am the founder and event creator for Bella's Lounge that you see out in the lobby. I believe in empowering black women because we are absolutely amazing, and I dare anybody to say any different. And so that's what I'm here for. We are powerful, beautiful women, and it has been my passion to make sure that the world knows that.
Okay, so first I want to talk about purpose, and I'm glad that you brought up this passion. I think it's so important to for people to realize the journey and what it took to get to that. So to dig a little deeper into who you all are, what was the defining moment for you when you knew, I am walking in my purpose of this entrepreneurial journey? Because it's not easy. A lot of people out here want to be entrepreneurs, but sometimes they don't see everything that has to go into that. And so what led you all to that point to know that I am walking, truly walking in my purpose? What was the defining moment?
You know, for me, I've been an entrepreneur for almost 30 years. But what I didn't know is that I can bless and help so many people just by teaching them what I knew. And what I mean by that is we're getting so much great information here today, but I want to make sure, because we've heard this over and over again, to apply it. So I remember sitting in seminars just like this, right? And I wanted to make sure that I could apply that information so that I can change my life and change my family's lives, but also change my community's life. And when I started seeing that happen, that's when I knew that I was walking in my purpose. Let me just say this really quick. There's a young lady here that was following me on social media, and she said, you don't even remember me, do you? And I said, no, I'm sorry, I don't. Come to find out, she's a client of mine. She thanked me, and I am so, so honored that I was able to do something in her life that now gives her purpose, and now she's here because of that today.
So for me, I always say that I have been really fortunate and blessed in my life to know from a very early age what my prime directive, for all my Trekkies out there, for what my prime directive is on this planet. And that is to love and make sure that others feel healthy, safer, and seen. And I remember being a child, and, you know, I'm the attorney, right? I remember being a child, and my favorite question is why, and I'm asking my mom, you know, why this, why that, why, and we see an unhoused person. I say, well, why doesn't that person have a house? And she goes back, oh, you know, et cetera. And then, you know, I'm still pushing, and then I remember her saying, Yasmin, that's just, it's because that's how the rules are written. It's because that is how the rules are written. That's how life shakes out. And so, of course, I look at her, and I say, well, who writes the rules? And she goes, the people in the suits, the lawyers, the judges, the politicians, they're the ones that write the rules. And so from that day, I said, I'm going to be one of the people that write the rules. And I locked in on that, and I continued. I went to the law school. I've worked for some of y'all's favorite politicians. I've done those things. And I have written rules, and it's when I get to step back, and exactly like your story, it's when I get to step back and I can see, I can physically put my hands on the lives I've changed. That's when I know that I'm walking in God's purpose for me, and it makes all of everything else superfluous. As long as I can see and feel and taste the change in someone's life and it being better, I know that I'm on the right track. And when I continue to do that without struggling against it, without fighting against it, without thinking that I know more than the universe, when I start leaning into that, that's when all the doors open. That's when I get the call. I don't even have to make calls anymore. I know exactly what my assignment is every single day because the Lord gives it to me very quickly. And as long as I accept it and do my best, they keep coming.
Do I get to say ditto? Just
ditto in a second.
Because truly, I always say progress comes in waves. So for me, I can't say there was one defining moment. I know there were all these waves that kind of pushed me toward my purpose, because what I do is very niche. It's very niche. Like someone asked me, does anyone do what you do? I was like, people do parts of what I do. We have accountants, we have researchers, we have all kinds of, I do it all. You know, so I can help from A to Z. And that's very niche in this space, but it's needed. But it was always, I had one prayer that I ever pray. And it's just that God showed me the next step. And it's like Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Like he creates the path. I don't know what's three or four steps down the way, but I just know the next step.
It's not
my
business.
And I start taking it. And then the path shows up and the doors open that I'm supposed to walk through. The doors close that I'm not supposed to. So I don't have to make a lot of decisions, which is beautiful, and it just takes me exactly where I'm supposed to go, and that's been the path that's got me right here, which is a very odd space, which is because it's God ordained, and I couldn't have imagined doing this. You know, this isn't something you say, I want to grow up and kind of do everything for and sit in the middle of all these organizations. It's not so. It had to be God, and it really is just the answer to that prayer.
For me, again, it's purpose. And you know, you have these ebbs and flows in life where you see things and you know that this is probably something you should do, but the world has its way of stripping that away from you and starting making you doubt yourself. And so I had to go through a lot of self-doubt, like, oh, maybe not, because that ain't looking like what everybody else doing, you know? And so I had to get to a point where that didn't matter anymore. So I actually was on a call with Mr. Dwayne Clark, who's the main organizer of this event, and we were arguing. And I said, he was like, you know, black men go through so much in this country. And I said, wait a minute, we're not doing that no more. We've heard that story and we agree with it, we know. But black women need to be seen. We go through a lot too. We're objectified, right? We are not seen sometimes. We don't get equal treatment a lot of times, and it's unfair. And then and on top of all that we go through in the world, we have to go home and be there for our men. We gotta love on y'all because we know you've gone through a lot in the world. So then we put ourselves in the background to make sure that you're okay. So I said to him, no. So I wanna do something to empower women, to remind my black sisters that we are important, we need to be seen, our purposes matter, and you know, we can still be all the things to you guys, but still love on ourselves. So that's when I created Bella's Lounge.
So the name of the conference is Wealth and Power, and you deal a lot with finances, investments. What are some of the biggest barriers now in our community that you're seeing people face in terms of just financial health, and what do they need to do to overcome that, to amass the wealth that we're talking about here?
Now you're talking my language. So we've talked a lot about houses today, right? So I need you guys to build your financial house. And what I mean is you need to have proper protection. You need to have debt control. You need to have an emergency fund. And the roof of the house is the investments. Get out of your own way. We don't trust one another. So I have all the tools that you need, you know, to get over whatever financial barrier where you are. But then if I reach out to you, you don't call me back. You don't keep your appointment. You don't do the things that you need to do to make sure that you can achieve the desired, you know, outcome. I believe that every family in here, you know how we're gonna change the narrative? Yes, it's gonna be with real estate, but it's also gonna be with making sure every single family has proper protection, has life insurance. Stop using GoFundMe. That's the easiest way to leave generational wealth. That is the easiest way. And let me say, stop shunning life insurance. Life insurance is a tool. See, other communities use life insurance strategies. Did you know that you can use life insurance for your real estate? So all my investors and things out there, there's things out there that you can use and use your life insurance for it. But you have to know these things. You have to be able to sit down and have that conversation in order to build wealth. See, the Bible says to leave a legacy of generational wealth to our children's children. However, we can't leave it to them because you don't have it. So it starts with the education, ladies and gentlemen. It starts with the education. We can build wealth. We can do anything that we desire to do in our hearts. Do you love yourself? Do you love your family? I heard something earlier, but I always use these P's. You know, make sure that you have your priorities over your the things that you want. We don't have our priorities in order. Have we bought enough stuff yet? You want to buy that piece of property, you want to buy that land, but have you bought enough stuff yet? See, I understand sacrifice. Are you willing to sacrifice today so that you can get and do what most people won't be able to do later? A budget is not restrictive, it's just giving your dollars an assignment. Does your dollars have an assignment? But last but not least, see, it's the weekend. We'll plan for the weekend, but you don't want to plan for your future.
Can you talk about, and I'm glad that you just brought up, generational wealth. You do so much in the community. It was probably about a year or two ago I interviewed you about Project Connect, and I just saw your passion to build wealth within the community, to build that knowledge. What needs to happen? What barriers are we facing now in the Austin community? And what are you doing to change that? What do we need to do to really elevate to the next level?
So I wear tons of hats. They call me Mad Hatter or the janitor because I have the keys to every room and all I do is clean up shit all day, everybody else's stuff. But I would say that the number one barrier, I think, in the generational wealth conversation for vulnerable populations and populations that have been historically marginalized and and not invested into, is the conversation about your estates. Okay, guys, I need us to have wills at this point. I need us to have wills. I need us to have powers of attorneys. I need us to have medical directives. I need us to have HIPAA releases, right? You can squander, you can sit here and write all the notes you want, and you can go and you can execute on that, and you can build generational wealth, and within months after you pass, your kids will squander it. And I'm telling you because I've seen it, okay? They will fight over that one gun. They will fight over that one necklace. They will fight over that house. And they will squander an attorney's fees. Now look, I will charge you. I will charge you to fight. And I tell my clients just like that, baby, if it's this important to you, hey, I'm not in your business. I'm not gonna tell you how to grieve. I'm gonna let you know how much money it's going to cost you though. And some people wanna take that fight. But if you don't plan for it, if you don't plan for what is, for most of us, the largest bequeath we will ever to give, the largest bequeath we will ever give in our lifetimes, which is when you pass, if you don't plan for that, you're gonna squander it. So that's number one, plan for your estate, right? Have those difficult conversations and not only for yourself, but for your family. I know it's hard to be the child and having to then parent your parent. I understand that but we must understand in our community and as humans, that's a natural progression for us, okay? We need to stop thinking about things as scary because we don't talk about them as a community. There's no more scary anymore. When you're trying to become the next millionaire, when you're trying to become financially free, when you're trying to become the family curse breaker, you need to open up your mouth and have some very authentic, transparent, and communicative conversations. And it starts at the dinner table. We need to start talking to our parents about how they're setting themselves up. And we need to start getting their business a little bit, because guess what? It's going to fall on you, and it's going to fall on your heirs. And then we are going to start over and over, every single generation. We got to start from ground zero, because we're not doing what we need to do for our families. It's a responsibility. It's an honor, and take it seriously. So talk to your family. Get your estates in order. Get your own estates in order. It's not that scary. And more, you know, and just overarchingly, sometimes also step out on faith. I see a lot of people a little scared to take some risk. I know we're in survival mode due to historical oppression. I understand. I'm there too. I fight against it every day. But look at yourself in the mirror. Don't take too many risks now. Don't go out here and be like, oh yes, told me to just do everything. Don't do that. I didn't tell you to go to the poorhouse now. But every so often, it is okay to say, I'm going to step out on faith.
I love that. You co-founded the African American Leadership Institute, really building capacity in our community. What kind of conversations do we need to have to continue building capacity among African Americans here in Central Texas?
Well, for one, I think this is a great one. Like really focusing on wealth management. I think for business owners, entrepreneurs, those who want to be, we've got you really have to do some planning. I actually tell people, don't quit your day job. Start building your business while you're still working. Like, that's the one thing. I worked a whole other contract while I was building 212 Catalyst just so I could build a reserve and paid myself very, very little, just enough to show a track record, but it was very small because I was just building a reserve for the business. But in addition to that, you need to think about how you're going to pay yourself. These 1099 gigs, know that Uncle Sam is going to get his 30% You don't make all of that money. That's why they get you at tax time, and suddenly you owe all this money. It can catch up with you if you're not of the right mindset. And when you're building a business, everything that you make isn't for you to just pay your bills, your personal bills. That's not the goal. You're gonna have to, you know, build in a profit margin and figure out what are your services worth. And when you get income, like some of that's going into the business, the reserve of the business, then you have to pay yourself. And as an entrepreneur, we have to also think beyond just what it takes to pay me for me to pay my bills, like my base salary or whatever. You have to think about your retirement plan, your own insurance, your employer. You don't have an employer taking care of this stuff for you, the benefits, health, all of these things. Like, you have to build in more than just your base salary. Like, all of this goes into, and then you start realizing it's a lot. And do you have a business plan that is really going to bring in the income that's going to do that? You can, but build it gradually over time, gradual and strong over time. And don't be in a rush to just jump off the cliff, because what's probably waiting for you is a lot of rocks. You're gonna hit your head on some hard things. And I did that. You know, I'm one of those that's tried to start businesses maybe 7 times, the statistical, you know, and they failed. And so, you know, 212 Catalyst is working fine. And with the African American Leadership Institute, I think it's just, you know, more conversation. Like, we actually had Tony Sanders at the Black X Conference in June. We're doing a financial, I don't want to say literacy, knowledge, wisdom kind of a session. We also talk about health and wellness. We talk about employment and technology and all these things, because they're all going to impact us. There's intersectionality between all of these. It's not just one topic or another. They all impact each other. Affordability and infrastructure and employment and transportation and all of that. And so where's local parks? Am I in a food desert? That affects your health and wellness and that of your family. So it's all interrelated. And that's what Ali does, is bring everyone together around all of these issues and also dive into how these are intersectional, and this is how they impact our community. And then these are the spaces that we can get involved in to make sure that our leadership is at the table along with everybody else.
That's good. And so I'm going to ask you a question, Tammy. I know they're kind of giving me the wrap because we want to take some audience questions. So be thinking of your questions right now. For you, Tammy, you have facilitated, you've helped facilitate this important space, this important conversation. We talk about the importance of conversations. Any important lessons that you have learned just in this process for people out there who maybe want to do the same thing, or they're ready? You asked a question earlier about taking a leap of faith as an entrepreneur. And so important lessons that help you take the leap of faith?
For me, I think it was just about time. It felt right, and I am a person of faith. I believe in God, and God was like, girl, what are you waiting for? You know, it was the fear. You know, I'm an accountant by trade, and so I was like, I'm good. I got my 401k. I'm living, you know. But God was like, you got to take a leap, take a jump, and that's okay. You will be fine. And it has been fine. It has been okay. And I got to tell you, it has made me look at my finances different, because running a business is not free. It does take money. You have to change. You know, you can't go get that Louis Vuitton purse sometimes. You got to back off of that. But one thing I also learned, y'all, and this is so important, is just real quick, when I came to Austin, I came here laid off. I had not a dollar to my name. I didn't have any money. I had to borrow money to get here. I sit here now with money in the bank, investments, I own my own home, you know, insurance. And people like Tony put me on that path, right? And what's important to know that I learned, which I was afraid of, is two things. I didn't want nobody to see my books. I didn't want nobody to know I had NSF fees, right? I didn't want people to know I was struggling, so I was afraid to ask for help. But once I did ask for help, you know, it took me like no time to get back on track. None. It was literally a matter of months before my credit score was back on track, before I had money in the bank, I had investments. I was gearing up to buy my house in literally months. So I'm talking to the people out here that's afraid to share your books. Share those statements, y'all. Trust me, you have to. So that's what, it, for me, I just knew it was time. I took that leap of faith and just believed in God for it.
Beautiful, beautiful. Now, I know you all have some questions. I think that we have time for two or three. I'm getting he's saying one, but who has a question now? Okay, yes, yes. And welcome to Austin. I think you said that you were new to Austin, so welcome. We are gonna love on you and embrace you. Let us know if you need anything. So I don't know if there's a mic. She says she has a loud voice, so you might just have to ask it.
What's up, y'all? Let's have a good question. How y'all doing?
So for me, I would say two things. One thing my trainer tells me, I just got back into the gym, so I have a little trainer. And one thing she always says when I'm on the treadmill and I feel like I'm about to die, when the workout is over after an hour, she look at me and be like, but did you die? You didn't die. You okay. And that's what I would say. You may fail. It may feel uncomfortable, but did you die? That means you still have a chance to do it again, right? And another thing I think, and I mentioned it during our Assets in Love panel, is collaboration. I think we have a problem in our community where we want to be independent. That is not a stunt, y'all. That's not a flex. Let it go. Okay, let's start changing that to self-sufficiency. It's okay to say I'm self-sufficient and proud, but it is also okay to ask for help. If your girlfriend got an extra room, you can sleep in, stay there. If your mom has an extra room, stay there. Go home. It's a reason why other communities, Hispanics, Asians, and others are thriving. It's because they have a sense of community and being together and helping each other. And we don't. We suffer from that. So move in with somebody else. Ask for help. Collaborate. If you got a dream, you can't build that dream by yourself, ask a friend for help. That is okay.
I'd say on a tactical level, line up your customers before you make the transition. Like when I started 212 Catalyst, I was back working in Austin Independent School District, and I knew I had about two or three clients already that I was either already serving or just gonna transition that was going to give me enough to just at least modestly live. Like, so, you know, run your concept by people. Start to say, is this a good, would you buy this? At what price point? Start figuring out, like, who your customers might be, who's committing, and have a little bit of a runway to slide on out so it's not just a drop.
I agree with both of those, and I would add, it's funny, I would add almost let go of the expectations that you've set for what you believe your life is supposed to look like and what your business is supposed to look like. It's in those expectations that we become disappointed. It's in those expectations that we don't leave room for God to do his redeeming thing. It's in those expectations that we lose sight that at this very moment, like right now, each and every one of you is living in your purpose. Each and every one of you is anointed and beautiful and has all the merit that anyone could ask for. You are there. You are doing it. It is happening. And even when you don't think that you're in a winning season, that L is just your lesson. You're just learning how to become your highest self. So I agree with definitely the logistics, right? Again, don't go out here and be like, yes, told me I could do anything. So I sold my house and now I'm on the road. No. Make sure you're smart now. But also just make sure that you take stock and happiness and joy in the abundance of this very moment, because that's where true freedom lies. When you can dispel all of what society has told you you have to be, and you can decide, oh, I'm the creator of this reality. And today and every single day, this reality is going to be abundant.
So let me just add this. Someone said it earlier, okay? We all have to learn to fail forward. There's gonna be some times that everything don't work out the way you planned, right? But it's okay, as long as you get back up. Just don't quit. I wanna say this, because I heard the lady say it. Sometimes while you're building your business, make sure that you keep your day job. There's nothing wrong with that. If you can build somebody else's dreams from 9 to 5, you can surely build yours from 6 to 10, 6 to 12, do whatever you have to do. But may I encourage you to get with someone who is in the space that you are in and have them mentor you. Maybe there's maybe one or two things that you can tweak that will turn this thing all around for you, and you won't continue to say, ooh, it's just not working out, but it will work out. I love what you said, sis, because I believe in that. See, we don't take losses here. We learn lessons. So there's a lesson, and it's all about timing. See, sometimes you want it to work in your time, but it's not about your time, it's God's time, okay? So keep that in mind.
He has
one
three.
More or no? Oh, okay.
All sorry, right. Can I just add on to that? He has three answers for you. It's either yes, so you get happy, yes, not yet, or I have something better. Yeah. Those are the only answers you get.
Unfortunately, we have to wrap up. These ladies will be around so you can ask them questions, but can you please just join me in giving them a round of applause? Phenomenal women. Thank you all so much for your time.
I got a minute to tell you about my wealth predicament. Root of evil villainous, but it broke the chip on my shoulder that I ascended with. Make a dollar, mimic it. Make 100, limitless. Using more gauge to gauge the debt that I've been living with power as a precedent. Get your crew and leverage it. The proof is in the pudding and the symbols in the lettering. Financial healing medicine. Your path to the precipice. You're shooting for your goal, so set your scope so you never miss. They want to lock you out. We're going to break into the top. Picking locks on open doors. This is what you've been hoping for. Swimming through depression, making stable steps on open floors. To cash rules everything but God, and that's my golden core. For me, I was having none and wanting more. I only had what I had stocked in store. Invest inside myself, so it's almost like my stock's insured. I was